Christ is in our midst. We have come to the fifth Sunday of the Great Fast, and it so turns out that we also celebrate the Feast of the Annunciation.
Conditions as
disciples at that time. Will you be able to stand up against the opposition? You describe it as being baptized with the baptism that I'm baptized with. I'm going to pick up that I bring up. All of those figures of his suffering and death. Will you, or can you, will you be able to do that? And the answer, he can. As a matter of fact, it shouldn't be. It did happen. I'm not sure that we have that question put to us now, that we would say, yes, we can. What will we do if the opposition and the persecution intensifies? Will we buckle over and act as if we didn't believe it? I think it's entirely appropriate for us, coming to the close of the Great Fast and celebrating the Annunciation, because it was to her, and I believe with all my heart, that it was because there was one person who was totally obedient to the will of God that God chose that time to come into the world. St. Paul says in Galatians 4:4, and in the fullness of time, God sent his Son, made of a woman, and throughout the time that he uses there is a second word that has to do with human history. When in the course of human history, one person became worthy of because of her total humility, a total obedience to the will of God, to be the mother of the one who would come into the world to reveal God and man to us. Jesus Christ, holy God, holy man, the only source of real knowledge about who man is, and certainly about God. So it's this that toward this end of the great fast we brought to our attention, to tell us that all the effort that has gone into our preparation up to this point is not only fully worth it, but we're going to be put to further tests. The next 2 weeks will be the harder weeks, the hardest weeks that we've got to face. But that's nothing compared to that test that we're put to in the leaders of this world. Do we stand out as those who have been reborn according to the image of God? Are we reflecting in all of our life that God is in us and we are in? This is the question that has brought me up to the end on this fifth Sunday of the Great Fast. For whom we glory, honor, and worship now and day for day.
Amen.
The morning for the second day.
the earth brought forth grass, and herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit, whose seed was in itself after his kind. And God saw that it was good, and the evening and the morning were the third day. Let him enjoy this fair and radiant triumphal feast. If any man be a wise servant, let him rejoicing enter into the joy of his Lord. If any have labored long in fasting, let him now receive his recompense. If any have wrought from the first hour, let him come today and receive his just reward. If any have come at the third hour, let him with thankfulness keep the feast. If any have arrived at the sixth hour, let him have no misgivings, because he shall in no wise be deprived therefore. If any man have delayed until the ninth hour, let him draw near, fearing nothing. If any have tarried even until the 11th hour, let him also be not alarmed at his tardiness. For the Lord, who is jealous of his honor, will accept the last even as the first. He giveth rest unto him who cometh at the 11th hour, even as unto him who hath wrought from the first hour. And he showeth mercy upon the last, and careth for the first. And to the one he giveth, and upon the other he bestoweth gifts. For he both accepteth the deeds, and welcometh the intention, and honoreth the acts, and praises the offering. Wherefore enter ye all into the joy of your Lord. Receive your reward, both the first and likewise the second. You rich and you poor together, hold high festival. You sober and you heedless, honor the day. Rejoice today, both you who have fasted and you who have disregarded the fast. The table is full laden, feast ye all sumptuously. The calf is fatted, and let no one go away hungry. Enjoy ye all the feast of faith. Receive ye all the riches of loving kindness. Let no one bewail his poverty, for the universal kingdom has been revealed. Let no one weep for his iniquities, for pardon has shone forth from the grave. Let no one fear death, for the Savior's death has set us free. He that was held prisoner of it has annihilated it. By descending into hell, he made hell captive. He embittered it when it tasted of his flesh. And Isaiah, foretelling this, did cry, "Hell," said he, "was embittered when it encountered thee in the lower regions. It was embittered, for it was abolished. It was embittered, for it was mocked. It was embittered, for it was slain. It was embittered, for it was overthrown. It was embittered, for it was fettered in chains. It took a body and met God face to face. It took earth and encountered heaven. It took that which was seen and fell upon the unseen. O death, where is thy sting? O hell, where is thy victory? Christ is risen, and thou art overthrown. Christ is risen, and the demons are fallen. Christ is risen, and the angels rejoice. Christ is risen, and life reigns. Christ is risen, and not one dead remains in the grave. For Christ, being risen from the dead, is become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. And to him be glory and dominion unto ages of ages.
Amen. Amen.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Nos vas Christ.
Hoy es nos vas Christ.
Jesús ha resucitado.
En verdad ha resucitado.
Ioanni iori te fukuin. Sono hi, sunamas chinamka no hajime no hi, sudeni kurete monto no atumareru tokoro mo, yudaya ji no soruru ni yorite, tojitaru ni iisusu kitarite, naka ni tachite, karera ni yu, nanjera ni heian, kore o iite, karera ni, onore no, te ashi o yobi waki, oshimiseri, Monto shu mite, yorokoberi, Iisusu, mata, karerani ite, nanjerani heia, shichiga, ware o tsukawashi shikotoku,
Waremo mata nanjirao sukawasu. Kore o iite ki o fukite, karerani yu se ishi no ukeyo, nanjirashto ni sono tsumi o yurusuba. Sunawachi, yurusaru. Shto ni sono tsumi o tomemiba, sunawachi tomeraru. Iisusu no kitarishi toki, juni no shtori naru foma, soshite didimo, というもの、彼らと共に歩さき。頼もんと彼に言えり、我ら主を見たり、しかれども彼を、彼はこれに言えり、我もしその手に釘の跡の水、我が指を釘の跡に入れず、我が手をその脇に入れずば、信ぜざらん。
Thank you.
day the Lord hath needed them, and straightway he will send them. And this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, Then the daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek and sitting upon an ass, with a colt, the foal of an ass. And the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them, and brought the ass and the colt, and put on them their clothes, and they set him thereon. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and screwed them in the way. And the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he was come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, What is this? Who is this? And the multitude said, This is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee. And when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were sore displeased, and said unto him, Hearest thou what these say? And Jesus said unto them, Ye have ye never read, out of the mouth of babes and sucklings, thou hast perfected praise.
Glory to thee, O Lord, glory to thee.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to thy great mercy, and according to the hope of thy transgressions, blot out thy transgressions. Wash me as long as my transgressions, and my sins are afraid of me. For I know my transgressions, and my sins continue under the Lord. Against thee, O Lord, and I sin.
Father, and the Son,
and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Manuel. Unto me prophesy, unto the wind, prophesy, Son of Man, and say to the wind, thus saith the Lord God, come, four winds of breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came unto them, and they lived, and stood up upon their feet, an exceeding great army. Then said he unto me, Son of Man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, our bones were dried, and our hope is lost, but we are cut off for our arms. Therefore, prophesy and say unto them, thus saith the Lord God, behold, O my people, I will open your graves, and cause you to come up out of your graves, and bring you into the land of Israel, and ye shall know that I am the man, that I am the Lord, when I have opened your gates, O my people, and brought you up out of your graves, and shall put my spirit in you, and ye shall live, and I shall place you in your own land. Then shall ye know that I, the Lord, have spoken it, and have performed it, saith the Lord.
Wisdom, the perfume out of the seventh stone, light and wood, let thy hand be lifted up, and let thy making myself till the end. Arise, O Lord, my God, let thy hand be lifted up, for I cannot by me be what's Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let God rise, O Lord.
Save us, O God, that He is our glorious Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Special services, we remembered all of those events, and yet at the same time, there was something that was, let's say, what do we do with it now that we know all of this? Well, the disciples knew exactly what they were to do with it, and that was to take it to the world and proclaim it. The world had to know that God had indeed come into the world, that God had come and taken upon himself human nature. And that man didn't like the fact that God was among them. God with us, Emmanuel. And there's been every attempt since then to discredit the idea of the incarnation. And it still goes on all the time. The apostles then were faced with the big test. They had to proclaim it to the outside world. So they met on the day of Pentecost, 50 days afterwards. One accord, and the Holy Spirit descended on them and empowered them to do what they had to do. Our problem is this too. We have to be endowed with power from on high if our mission to the world is to be anything like a success. We like that term success because it's engraved in our it's society as kind of a the opposite of favor. Endowed with power from on high. The church, look at the condition of the great body of people in the world who declare Christ to be the Savior of the world and their Savior, their God among them. And the differences that divide Christians. And we could talk about that all day, but there's something much more current and much more important in a sense. You can never say that the division among Christians is not important. Still, we're faced with our own obligation to proclaim the truth about Christ to the world. And I sometimes look at the amount of time that's spent in the preoccupations that govern our use of time. We have not just the power from on high to do what we're supposed to do. We've been given a set of rules that have accumulated over 2,000 years of existence. These are called the canons. And there's nothing about which there's more controversy than the volumes and volumes of canons that govern the church. So there's a division as to which canons apply and which do not apply. But even worse, when it comes to leading the Christian life, so much of our time is spent in organizational matters. Look at the witness of the Orthodox Church in this country. How many jurisdictions do we have? Sometimes they're emphasizing not the message of Christ, but they're... I didn't take that as a rejection. I guess I could have. But so much of our time is spent in defining areas of responsibility and areas of power. We have divisions among us because of that. And I say it's for one reason only. Our mind has been taken away from the very reason for our existence. The eyes have been taken off Jesus Christ and placed on something else. Our position, our standing in this world, our organizational skills, or whatever they may be. But you see, the reason that the early church was able, when the Holy Spirit descended upon them, to convert half the world to the way of Christ, was because they believed and they accepted that as the primary reason for their existence as a church. If God wills, in our own time, we can pray constantly and earnestly that God would give back to the church the vision that would make it a force among men. Nowadays, so often it's simply relegated to, oh, that belongs to old times or former times. But the vital message of Christ and the necessity for Him to give us life and give meaning to the life that we have is just as current, but if not more so than it ever was. So again, let's pray on this day of Pentecost that the Holy Spirit not only may descend on us to keep the faith, but to realize our obligation to pass that faith to all the people of our surroundings that desperately need it, because they're leading at this moment a totally pointless existence. Christ was the one who gave life meaning. He's the one that redefined it for us, made us understand that it was not an end in itself, but pointed to being with God eternally in His kingdom. It's that Jesus Christ who proclaimed this message to the world. That is the reason for our being here. Our reason for being here is Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who brought us. The presence of the Father, and then enlisted the aid of
of the Holy Spirit to complete his work. To him be glory, honor, and worship now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Another parable spake he unto them, the kingdom of heaven is like human race without doubt is just one more species of animals. Because God has given us his image, he has come and visited us in such a profound sense. He came into the world and took upon himself our nature so that he could talk to us, not through the marvels of nature, but in person, himself, talking to us, directing and explaining to us who we are and what our destiny is. This we reaffirm in the season of All Saints. We affirm, first of all, that we have accepted this as the goal of our own life. To be a Christian and not to have a goal to be like Christ is to misunderstand the calling altogether. We've come together because we have agreed this is the will of God, because God has revealed it to us what we should be like. True manhood, true humanity in himself. Now,
day after Pascha, we celebrate the descent of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost. All the Sundays following Pentecost carry the name first, second, third, fourth Sunday after Pentecost. We're still in the Pentecostal season. This is the third Sunday. What happens during the Pentecostal season is that we are reminded regularly of the descent of the Holy Spirit The Holy Spirit didn't simply descend for no good reason except just to add some kind of further dimension to the church. The Holy Spirit descended precisely to make saints out of the people that were members of the church. The Spirit of the Holy Spirit of God descended upon the apostles, and he was the Spirit of holiness, and he came in order to sanctify, not just to add one more commemoration or feast day or something of the sort to our church, but to let us know that the calling of every single person who has chosen to bear the name of Christ, and this is precisely what we are here. We are people who have chosen to brand ourselves with that name of Christ. And there's a calling that's special for all those who have made that decision. You may say you've had it all your life, and that's good enough, except that there's a point when you reach a certain level of maturity when you have to decide whether you keep it or you don't keep it. And as we know perfectly well from past history, many people decided when they reached a certain age that they would not brand themselves with the name of Christ any longer. So this is an extremely important moment for us, because we're given the opportunity every year because of the commemoration of the descent of the Holy Spirit. We're given this opportunity to say, to commit ourselves once more to Christ and his way, or abandon it completely, one or the other. As if we were saying, this is the essence of what we're doing here. You accept Christ as the principle, the guide, the orientation of your whole life, or nothing. He's not kind of an added decoration to the rest. He either shapes our whole life or he does not. Now, those who, on that first Pentecost, received the Holy Spirit were empowered to do all kinds of things. When we celebrate annually the descent of the Holy Spirit, we're very conscious of the fact that the Holy Spirit's descent was not simply an event of some time in the past, but it is a condition or an atmosphere in which you and I, as followers of Christ, always live. Even though there's a sect that has adopted the name for itself, we are the Pentecostal Church par excellence. The Pentecostal Church. Because we believe in the descent of the Holy Spirit. We believe that he sanctified us and made saints. And that the calling in every single one of us, because of the descent, the availability, as it were, of the Holy Spirit, we have this calling and the necessary help needed in order to become saints. Sometimes it's very difficult for us to realize that this is the calling of every one of us. We don't have a mild calling like just be a member of the church, don't cause trouble, and you'll be all right. That's not what we're all about. Each person is called to be a saint, and all of the necessary supports and helps that are possible, that are given to us so that we might achieve that sanctity. Sanctity, which is something that somehow sets us apart, makes us different from the average person around us. Until we realize that and accept it, accept the essence of it, what it really constitutes. The Christian I don't care if it's in a friendly society, and, you know, we're the 2,000 years of Christian history. We've experienced quite a number of different relations with societies and governments. There was the first period in which everything was totally hostile. Then there was a period of time in which the church became the state church of the empire, which was probably the, although many people look upon it as the period when the church really blossomed. Matter of fact, it was in many ways when the church became the state religion, it was the death of the church. You see, it had been vibrant and alive and bringing, able to convert and bring lots of people to it as the state church. You know? So a mistake in history was made. But we're over that now. We have no connections, probably. I don't think there's a single place in the world that still has the Orthodox Church as the official state church, if it's not perhaps well, I can't think of any of them. At one time, all of the Balkans and Russia and so on had the Orthodox Church as the state church, the state religion, with some support more or less from the government. But the point is, for us now, at this point, we have to relate ourselves to this event that has just taken place, the descent of the Holy Spirit. And the descent of the Holy Spirit, again, gives us the equipment whereby we might achieve that sanctity, but it also provides the opportunity for many of us to think of ourselves as being somehow superior to and more advanced spiritually, better off than other people. So, here, within the confines of the Christian group, what we so often find, instead of the peace and harmony and the mutual respect that we should have, that's precisely what should characterize us as members of the church. We love each other, we respect each other, because we know that we have this common destiny in Christ. What do we hear? So-and-so is this way, so-and-so is that way. Detraction, criticism, really is divisive, and it's almost as if to say, I cancel for myself this descent of the Holy Spirit. So what? It's basically what we're saying. Every time you lift your voice in criticism and derision of some member of the church, you're doing exactly that. You're saying the descent of the Holy Spirit doesn't apply to me. It doesn't count. We have to think about that rather seriously, because there's nothing as much taken for granted these days as the possibility for us to find fault with every single person in the church other than ourselves. Every single. This is a time of Pentecost, a time of sanctification, a time when we're called to reevaluate our relationship with this faith, make up our minds whether we really take it seriously and was set out on the road to holiness, or simply become a kind of passive member and more or less belonging to the church as we would belong to any other organization. No, but this is the place where men's salvation is worked out. Once you realize that and understand it and accept it, then some of the pettiness that goes into finding fault with not only the clergy, but everybody else, maybe some of that will disappear if we ever really realize what is taking place here. I say that one of the main reasons why we do some of the things that we do is precisely because we've not really fully accepted and digested the idea of what really happens here. We're here, open, waiting for the descent of the Holy Spirit. He'll be rejected when he finally does descend upon us. This is the question we have to ask ourselves. Again, Holy Pentecost season, and we'll count our Sundays from here on in for quite some time as such and such a Sunday after Pentecost, because what we have to be reminded of again is that the entire life of the church refers back to Pentecost, the descent of the Holy Spirit, and the basic proposition that the Holy Spirit has brought to us is that the possibility of our being sanctified, our being made holy, this is what we're here for. We're not here simply so that we might have a hope, a religion, because everybody, after all, must have a religion. To Christ, who gave us the model of what it is to be a child of God, who gave us the formula for understanding what it is to be man and woman, true to our calling, as Christ, to him be glory, honor, and worship now and for the ages of ages.
Amen. Amen.
Curiously, among the 10 lepers, one being a Samaritan, Samaritans, you know, was someone who participated to a certain extent in the Hebrew heritage, but had many other religious elements added, so that Samaritan religion was rather difficult to define. Certain other kind of movement that we have seen, in which every time someone is dissatisfied, even slightly, with some of the proceedings or the teachings, they form another one. And so there were all kinds of derivatives from the Hebrew faith that were present among those Samaritans. I think it's important for us to try to see what a particular lesson from the Holy Gospel has to do with our own situation. We have also, in our own case, and we're conscious of the fact that we hold the fullness of the Christian faith. This is that's why many of us who didn't begin this life as Orthodox became Orthodox, precisely because the Orthodox Church has the fullness of the Christian faith. And we literally turned our backs on that place that we came from. Well, sometimes when we analyze the situation in which we find ourselves, we have received enormous benefits from God Himself. What is the degree to which we who are ever faithful could not be classified as some kind of Samaritan or newcomer or Protestant or whatever you want to call it? To what extent do we remember when things have happened to us and we've asked for and been granted forgiveness? What kind of thanksgiving do we offer back in return? Maybe we're somehow like the nine in today's lesson and took it for granted that that forgiveness was simply there for the asking. And this is not out of keeping with what we choose either. Forgiveness is there for the asking. But on the other hand, what do you do in response to having been forgiven? Do you give thanks for it? Do we have a kind of a tradition in our own country of Thanksgiving? And sometimes I find people who are really openly declared atheists celebrating Thanksgiving in a big way. And I remember one time I said to a friend of mine who was a confessed atheist, or at least he liked to call himself an agnostic. Not that he denied the existence of God, but he just didn't know whether there was one or not. But he celebrated Thanksgiving always in a big way. And I used to ask him, why on earth do you celebrate Thanksgiving? He said, well, I don't know. I have this feeling that somehow I have a kind of respect for some unnamed and unidentified force, or if you want to call it a person, who has arranged things for me in such a way that I'm more or less enjoying life. I wonder if that's what the definition of Thanksgiving is for a large number of our people. Maybe they don't articulate it in quite the same way. But there was a procedure that the man was to follow. He was to go show himself to the priest. All of them were to show themselves to the priest. And the priest would be the one who would be able to declare authentically, that is, with authority, that these people had been cleansed of their leprosy, of their disease, because no one from no other source could that authentication come, only from the priests. And they understood, as they had been instructed by Christ to go show yourselves to priests. And as they went, they were cleansed. And all the majority, the nine, simply went their way. And it was the Samaritan among them who turned and gave thanks. The real important thing for us to draw from this particular lesson in the gospel is this. Do we take for granted God's benefactions, his working in our life, in whatever form it may be, whether it's acquiring some position we like, whether it's living in a particular area, whether it's having so many earthly goods, whatever it may be, do we remember to give thanks because God has rescued us from a meaningless and purposeless existence. This is what we're celebrating here. The very fact that God has told us what it means to be a human being, that is to be one who is a child of God, grateful to him for the things that he's done, and always keeping him in remembrance. This is the remembrance of where everything came from. The human being has received from God all that he is, and he is to be thankful for. To him be glory, honor, and worship, and praise be to God.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Christ is born.
Glorify him.
Jesus Christ.
Magnifico.
Cristo ha nascido. In verità ha nascido. During the last few days, without any doubt, not only I, but a number of other people have reviewed in their minds the whole proposition, which is the basis of our Christian faith. God became man. God entered into this world of ours and took upon himself our own nature, lived and walked among people, shared our life with us. What a unique thing as far as religion is concerned. There's no other religion that has any, even a remote similarity to God's taking human nature and living and walking among us. Precisely, why? Why was it necessary for God to do that? I saw a little book the other day that the title really intrigued me because I'd been thinking about the proposition that we are going to deal with today. That is, God became man. The little book had to do with, it said, matter of fact, the title was From Image to Likeness. From Image to Likeness. Remember that when man was created, the Holy Trinity is reported to have said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. Image is something that has been given to every person that's born into the world, every human being. But his task is to achieve the likeness of God. In other words, the reason that God himself was incarnate and lived and walked among us was precisely that he might show us what it was to achieve God's likeness. God's likeness, what does it mean? It means to have the greatest possible respect to every other human being, to give of your heart and your means, your kindness, everything you can possibly do, and treat every person that you encounter with honor as an image of God. So this is basically what the theme of our celebration on the Nativity of Christ. Why was the eternal Son of God incarnate? Why did he come into this world and partake of all of our life, no matter what the ups and downs were, the good part and the bad part as well? He came into this world and became one of us and shared all of our life with us so that we might know from him personally what it is to achieve the likeness of God. This likeness we saw in person in Christ himself. It's a matter of historical record now. Christ, the eternal Son of God, becomes man in order that we might know what it is that our purpose in being, our very existence, what's the reason for it? That is to be like God, to know him, and to achieve our destiny in him. To him be glory, honor, and worship, and honor to the ages of ages.
Amen. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Christ is in our midst.
He is and ever shall be.
It's an ironical thing that in the various Christian churches, at the so-called Epiphany, or as we call it, theophany, the manifestation of God. And epiphany is nothing more than manifestation. But on the other hand, it's almost as if it were a sort of a secondary feast. It's almost not, it's not, doesn't rank as it does in our church with, as among the major feasts. As a matter of fact, if we consider the Nativity of Christ and the Theophany, we would probably have to say that we have one single feast day, which is the Manifestation of God. Began with the birth of Jesus and then his asking for baptism. In the Orthodox Church, there probably are places in which much more emphasis is given to the Theophany than it is even to the Nativity. But be that as it may, there's one great feast day that we are celebrating, and that is the Manifestation of God. God Himself, because of His extreme, His unbounded love for man, came into this world and took upon Himself our nature, became one with us, and behaved as man was supposed to behave. In other words, man had lost sight of what his purpose was even over the course of history. He was as if He lived as if this world and this world itself, the only thing there is. He didn't live as if this life was a preparation for the life to come. This is the most important thing, the most important aspect of this life of ours. It's relatively brief, even if for some it just goes on and on. But at the same time, considering time itself, it's a relatively brief time that we're on this earth. Therefore, it would be rather a pointless existence if there were not something to which this life pointed, and for which it was not a preparation. So this life is very much that. So in order for us to not to lose sight of the real purpose of our existence in this world, God Himself came into the world and became one of us so that He could show us, not just tell us, as it were, but to show us in every act. Well, John was baptizing. This was, even baptism at the time of John had a certain amount of history because the Hebrew people had often responded to the call of the prophets and found themselves needing cleansing, and therefore they ritually cleansed themselves. Of course, the ritual cleansing was simply a sign of a profound inner cleansing. And if the profound inner cleansing is not there, then the ritual cleansing is rather pointless. Yet, at the same time, when John came and baptized, people came to him confessing their sins. And then, the most extraordinary thing of all is that Jesus Christ, the God-man, comes to John and asks for baptism. And John, of course, recognized who it was, or at least recognized his utter sinlessness, and he forbade him. And then the Lord said the most extraordinary statement maybe in the entire New Testament. Suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. What a strange remark, if you will consider from the point of view of our understanding of the individual words. And what is righteousness after all? Righteousness. That is, it has to do with God's relation with his created beings, the human race. It has to do with the relation of the human race to God. And it has to do with the relationship among human beings themselves. Righteousness. It's not just another word for piety or religious or something like that. No, it really means having the right kind of relationship. Matter of fact, I'm glad we have the word as we do in English, because right is the base of the word, and it comes from the Greek word, which is dikaiosyne, and that means exactly rightness. Because what we're concerned with and became concerned with the incarnation of the eternal Word of God, was precisely that rightness which was missing. So if he is going to point the way to us, show us what our destiny should be, and what the meaning of this life is, then he begins by showing us what real righteousness is. And so he then accepts the task, the burden, if you will, of demonstrating by every act in his life the real righteousness, thus becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. He is the incarnate Son of God, performed everything exactly the way it was supposed to be, with his fellow man, and with God himself, with the Father. So it's this manifestation of the eternal Son of God at his baptism as the God-man, in which he declares the purpose, really the purpose, for his being among us. So this completes, for all practical purposes, the whole celebration of the incarnation of the eternal Son of God, the presence of God himself with us. To him be glory, honor, and worship now in the age of Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
A lot of remarks to make, but I would like to say, first of all, that we congratulate our church in Jackson, Florida, the ordination of Theodore. It's part of the age thing, you know. Theodore to the diagonal. I was even telling him I was deeply impressed with his sermon, and I know he's going to be a very fine pastor, because shortly his sponsor is going to be asking for his ordination to the priesthood, and we'll be very happy to do that. I noticed that we've let our the practice that we were trying to revive. You know, when we come to the point of creed, that is when the mutual love of all the people who hold the same faith in Jesus Christ is manifest. And that exchange, whether it's a handshake, a hug, or a kiss, or whatever it is, it was called the kiss of peace in the early church, and it was there specifically because we were acknowledging that we had at our side fellow believers in the same Lord Jesus Christ and his salvation. So let's not let that go by the wayside. After a couple of Sundays, it seemed to get weaker and weaker. And today I noticed almost no exchange. So let's pick it up again, if you will. Is there anything else I need to say?
Well, that's up to you.
Well, I get prompted by my collaborators and associates, so I thought maybe there was something I well along in the fasting period. What is it, fourth Sunday? And so we'll be celebrating Pascha before tomorrow. Father, the monastery of the Nativity of the Virgin Mary is a reality. It is being formed under the not exact direct supervision, but certainly with the approval of Metropolitan Jonah and of course with your local clergy being also very involved and very supportive of the effort. The Orthodox Church, as you always you know, has always depended very heavily on the prayer that comes from the monasteries. And most of us are too engaged in making a living for ourselves and living a life of just ordinary citizens that we cannot spend the whole day in prayer. But the monks and nuns do. And so we sponsor them. We like having them close by so that we can be assured that prayer is being said on our behalf in this part of the world. Again, welcome to those who may be visiting. We hope you'll come back and be with us again. And we'll have the prayers of thanksgiving. Glory to thee, our God, glory to thee, our God, glory to thee, our God.
I thank you, Lord.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Christ is in our midst.
He is and ever shall be.
We have come to that point of the year, which is really crucial, because it was crucial in the life of the Savior. We have a fortunate occurrence in English. Our word crucial is related to cross. The moment of the cross. The moment in which the world must face up to itself, what it is, what it means, what life is all about. A theme that I've often referred to, and I hope you won't mind my referring to it again, and that is Jesus Christ came into the world, that his eternal God, eternal Son of God, came into the world because man had not achieved what God had given him to achieve. Man was made in God's image. He had one great task to fulfill, that is to achieve the likeness of God. That's where he failed. But Christ came in order to demonstrate to us, not just tell us, but really demonstrate to us what it was to achieve the likeness of God. He became man in the full sense of the word, so that he could tell us face to face about God and about what God wanted out of us. This notion is popularly rejected by religion, because, as it turns out, in the history of the world will demonstrate that man wants to figure out God and describe him on his own terms. God's intervention into human life, into the history of the world, demonstrates that God loved us and cared for us so much that he did not endure to see us waste the existence that he'd given us, to live a life of total meaninglessness, because without God, that's what life is, without meaning. So he came into the world, curiously. The thing that's rejected by other religions And precisely when religion came into existence on the basis of a rejection of Christ as the Son of God. It's a worldwide religion now. It's even gaining momentum in our own country. Jesus Christ is a prophet, not the Son of God, it says. So, coming back to the lessons that we have read for today. Yesterday, of course, was Lazarus Saturday, the scene of the greatest miracle of Christ, to restore to life a man that was not only dead, but is dead 4 days and had begun to smell. The men of religion, oddly enough, of Christ's own time, in spite of the fact that he had raised Lazarus from the dead, they plotted to kill Lazarus again. How strange, how utterly strange that the relationship between man and God should ever reach such a low level. But that was it, killing the whole world, they say, because of the miracle of the restoration to life of Lazarus, the whole world has gone after him. Those religious people said, and we can't stand that. So then, now today we come to the entry into Jerusalem, Palm Sunday. And the picture is of children singing. What's really meant is that people who will have the innocence of children will welcome Christ as he comes into our city, our midst, our lives. So what remains for us to say, what will happen? Those same children, as it were, some days later, will not say, Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. What will they be saying? Crucify him. Is it the same people? It doesn't tell us in the gospel, but it seemed pretty likely. The crowd that was caught up by the spectacle is the same crowd that was caught up by a kind of popular idea. Let's get rid of this one. So, what does this mean to us today? We've gained the victory over death. We are in anticipation of being with Christ eternally in his kingdom. What does this translate into our behavior here? Are we guilty of crucifying Christ in our own way? To crucify him simply to eliminate him from all consideration. If he's taken into consideration no matter what the activity is, especially with relations with other people, then we have Christ as our guide, one who's guiding us. But if not, we have said for all practical purposes, crucify him, because he doesn't say what we want him to say in this given situation. This person deserves my distrust, my mistreatment, my hatred. Can we be brought to that level that we'd say crucify Christ in that indirect way? So let's go from all of these experiences of Lazarus Saturday, Palm Sunday, all the Holy Week services, paying close attention so that we may, at the end of all of that, make a new resolve. We might have to make it more than once in our life, but let's make the resolve to follow Christ and him alone, and let him dictate how we behave with our neighbor and our fellow man. To him be glory, honor, and worship now and for ages of ages. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Christ is in our midst. Recently, in studying the Gospel of St. Mark, I was struck by the statement that from that time on Jesus began to speak to them in parables. I'm going to talk about one of the parables that he used as an illustration this evening. The parable of the vineyard. Many of you, I'm sure, are familiar with it. The man planted the vineyard. Everything was in place. All was in order. And he went off into our country. And he led it out to what we call husbandmen, keepers. And from time to time, he would send his representatives in order to get a report on what had happened in the vineyard, or maybe collect some of the crops that were put there. But the owners of the vineyard were not pleased at being checked on. So they beat one, killed another, so on. Read the parable and take my stuff for in the 12th chapter. I'm thinking in our own case, the human race was created by God to know Him through His creation. And men ended up knowing everything but God through the creation, then something was radically wrong. So he sent from time to time prophets. The prophets would proclaim the will of God and his purpose in having created it. But man had grown so independent and he paid no attention to the prophets. Biblical language, they beat some and they killed some. They ran them away. And then finally, because we're talking about the incarnation, the Lord says, I'll send my son, the reverence him. Of course, the word reverence is put in a kind of a future in the Greek language, which is a hope rather than a definite fact. It may be that they will reverence my son, some translations have it, or maybe they will. Whatever the case was, the son came, presented himself, and the reaction was something like this. Aha! This is the heir. Let's kill him. And then the inheritance will be ours. This is like a thumbnail sketch of man's decision. Maybe not expressed in so many words, or as succinctly as that. Man's decision to do without God. And he couldn't, because man was made in God's image. And he had the purpose of achieving God's likeness. That was built into his creation, to achieve God's likeness. So, the men said, and the inheritance will be ours. That's like saying, we don't want God's design in this world. The way we behave, the way we conduct our business, the way we conduct our relationships. We don't need his intervention. That's it. The inheritance precisely needs that. But he sent his son, and his son was rejected. We all know that. But it was in that rejection that the separation between those who aspired to faith in God and those who
one who separated himself completely and lived as if there were no God. Surprising how many people in this world think that they can live without any kind of a concept of God. There are people in our own society. I say they're simply coasting on the faith of other people. The faith of people that believe deeply in God and understand that our purpose, having been God, made in God's image, our purpose is to achieve the likeness. That's why Christ came. So we have some idea of what that likeness was. So he came and come, let us kill him. What a polite language, so let's kill him. But at any rate, that's where we keep doing it. Come, let us kill him. Every 3 hours. If we can get rid of this air, then we can model our lives on as we want. We don't have to listen to any kind of dictates from the outside. We can do it ourselves. It's like the rejection, the expectation, the rejection of God's message among men. Well, we have Christ finally came, and he did tell us exactly about God, what God wants us, what we're expected to be like as human beings, what it is to be a man and a woman in this world. We heard directly from Christ what happened to him. He was killed too, because the parable was simply a summary or a foreshadowing of the events of Christ's life. He was rejected, he was shut down. And in spite of the fact that we surround ourselves with dozens and dozens of people who are fellow believers, all of you, still there's a world out there that doesn't know you, God has rejected Christ's message. So we're here to reaffirm and strengthen our faith in Christ as the one who has all of the answers insofar as man's purpose for being. All of the very reason for his being, the reason for his life is precisely revealed to us by Jesus Christ. So we celebrate the presence of Jesus Christ throughout history, from the time of his own physical presence in the world to his continued presence, which is spiritual and felt deeply and strongly by all of us here this evening. I can say only this for all of you. You do believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He came into the world to teach us about God. The world in general turned him down, but we have not turned him down. We said yes. This is what we believe. To him be glory, honor, and worship, and honor, and praise God.
Lord, now let your servant depart in peace according to your word. All my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the nations, and the glory of your people Israel.